Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is Dr. Shilpi here, and in this video we will be talking about dental considerations in liver patients. So let's get started. So whenever we talk about a liver patient in a dental clinic, you know, the dental considerations come down to basically three important points. The first very important point is that some of the drugs that we administer in such patients get metabolized in the liver. So there can be unpredictable hepatic metabolism of the administered drugs seen in such patients. Then some of the proteins and clotting factors are produced in the liver, and whenever there is any kind of liver disease, the production of the clotting factors decreases, and because of that you can see defective hemostatic cascade or decreased production of the coagulation factors. So you can see increased, you know, clotting time in these patients because there is reduced production of the coagulation factors, and also there is thrombocytopenia, that is the number of platelets, the platelet count in such patients decreases. It decreases because there is hypersplenism in these patients. Then another thing that we see in these patients is increased risk of infection. The immunity of the patient is reduced, and therefore there is increased risk of infections in such patients. And we need to consider these three important points whenever we are treating any liver patient in a dental clinic. Then whenever a liver patient visits in a dental clinic, during that time, it's very important that you extract the history of the patient. You always, the history is very important. So you need to ask about any kind of history of hepatitis or any kind of surgeries, or what are the medications that the patient has been taking, or alcohol intake, because certain drugs that you prescribe in these patients, antibiotics, might interfere with alcohol as well. Then another thing, sometimes the patient will not be telling you or giving you a direct history of any kind of liver disease. In such patients, it's very important that you know how to identify the patient. You need to know some basic signs which can be seen in such patients. You can see jaundice, you can see clubbing of fingers. Then you can also see ascites in the patients where there's fluid collection in the peritoneum, swollen ankles. Then you can also see this hepatosplenomegaly. Then clubbing of fingers can be seen. Opaque nails dikh sakte hain, jisko leukonychia, we call it as leukonychia. Palmar erythema, you can see redness in the palms. Then you can see parotid swelling, that is psilosis, you can see in the patient. Ye basically, this is not because of liver disease as such, but parotid swelling, psilosis, basically seen due to the alcohol intake in such patients. Then you can see caput medusae, you can see spider nevi, mostly front side pe dikhte hain. Then oral manifestations are also very important. You can see petechiae, bruising in such patients. If the bilirubin count has been very high when the teeth were developing, you can see green discoloration of teeth in such patients. You can see enlarged pulp chambers in such patients. Patients can present with xerostomia, dry mouth ho sakta hai, Sjögren syndrome ke symptoms ho sakte hain. Then also the patient can present with lichen planus. The patient can present with lichen planus, patient can present with candidiasis. So all these manifestations are basically not direct manifestations of a liver disease, but due to the medications, the patients are on a lot of medications like interferon therapy and all. Because of that, you know, we can see candidiasis and we can see lichen planus in such patients. Another thing, we can see a particular breath, foetal hepaticus, that we call as, we can see some liver breath in such patients. So why do you need to know the oral manifestations? So if the patient doesn't tell you about the history properly, at least you can take adequate precautions. You would know when you are treating the patient, you don't fall into trouble. If you extract a tooth or something, patient should not start bleeding. So it is very important that the oral manifestations, the dentist is aware of the oral manifestations of in these patients. Then coming to the dental considerations, the first dental consideration is that the patient with ascites, it is very difficult to fully recline the chair in some dental procedures. So when you are treating a patient with ascites, one very important thing is that the dental chair position, you have to ask the patient in whichever position the patient is come. You have to lower the chair first and make the patient sit, and then you should recline the chair and place the chair in the position in which the patient is most comfortable in. Then another thing is, in these patients you can see risk of immune infection, because there's altered immune defenses in these patients. Also, it has been found out there is a positive correlation that has been seen between the advanced stage of cirrhosis and patients who have advanced stage of cirrhosis. Those patients present with, you know, increased apical periodontitis or pockets greater than, there is increased periodontal disease that is seen in these patients, pockets greater than 6 mm or root fragments or large loss of bone support can be seen in these patients. And also, because these patients, cirrhosis patients, liver patients are, do have a history of alcohol. If they have a history of alcohol, then this alcohol also interferes with the protein metabolism and tissue healing, which is why, you know, this is also related with periodontal disease. Another thing, with alcohol also increases the serum cytokines in cirrhosis, and this is also implicated in periodontal disease. Then the next thing is, next implication and risk of infection is, because these patients are at a higher risk of infection, it is advised that these liver patients, whenever you have a liver patient, you ask them that they go for regular dental checkups. They should maintain a good oral hygiene, and they should prevent oral inflammation, and they should avoid invasive treatment. So whenever we are treating a liver patient, antibiotic prophylaxis is very, very important. So we usually can prescribe amoxicillin, can be prescribed in these patients, because amoxicillin is metabolized in the kidney and not in the liver. So amoxicillin can be given, but Amclav should not be given. Amoxclav combination should not be prescribed in the liver patients. There is no, as such, no antibiotic prophylaxis protocol which is there for liver patients, but the regular drugs that we give, that is penicillins or metronidazole, is also given in such patients. It can be given 500 mg 1 hour before the procedure, or 2 grams of amoxicillin alone can be given to such patients. If the patient is allergic to penicillins, in those cases, 600 mg of clindamycin can be given 1 hour before the procedure. So clindamycin also has a risk of liver damage, but still, if the patient is allergic to penicillins, we need to weigh the risk-benefit ratio, and we can give clindamycin in such patients. Another thing, cephalosporins, they can cause cholestatic hepatitis. Macrolides can also result. They are also hepatotoxic. Then even erythromycin, all these things can cause acute liver failure and death. So liver damage can occur due to clindamycin also, but still it is the second drug of choice if the patient is allergic to penicillin. Then even quinolones, there are few cases of hepatotoxicity that is seen in case of quinolones, and there can be increased serum transaminase and hepatocellular damage or cholestasis and acute liver failure that can be associated with quinolones. And tetracycline and all should also be avoided entirely. Even metronidazole, it has to be avoided, because it can produce serious reactions. Apart from its regular side effects, it can produce serious reactions with patients who are taking alcohol. But even though it has to be avoided, metronidazole is still can be considered in few cases, considering the risk-benefit ratio in a patient. It can vary from case to case. Then coming to the hemostatic alterations, history is very important. Then there's reduced factor 2, factor 7, factor 9 and factor 10 in such patients. And we need to advise certain tests, bleeding time, clotting time, and also liver function tests, CBC, platelet count in such patients before we start or plan any kind of treatment. It's very important that we also do a cross consultation with a specialist or ask the general physician of the patient. Always take consultation from the specialist before we think about or plan any kind of treatment in such patients. So for any kind of minor surgeries like extractions, simple extractions or small flap procedures, the platelet count should be minimum between 50,000 to 55,000 per microliter. And similarly, for any kind of major surgical large flaps or multiple extractions in bone surgery, it has to be greater than or equal to 1 lakh per microliter. Then you can also prescribe antifibrinolytics preoperative to such patients before performing any kind of surgery. Also, in pre-transplant patient, whenever you are doing extraction, if the INR is less than or equal to 2.5, INR usually is 1, the normal value, it has to be somewhere between 1, 1.1 like that. And if the INR is less than or equal to 2.5, then and also the platelet count is greater than 30,000 per microliter, in such cases, when you are doing a simple extraction, you can basically compress a surgical wound with the gauze for some time. Antifibrinolytic agents such as EACA or tranexamic acid can be given in such patients. They inhibit fibrinolysis. Then intranasal desmopressin can be given. It increases the production of factor 7 and it increases von Willebrand factor, and it is a good alternate for patients in which you cannot do platelet transfusion. So whenever the platelet count is between 30 to 50,000 and the INR is between 2 to 3, and in such patients, platelet transfusion cannot be given due to some other reason, in such patients, we can give this desmopressin. They are a good alternate. Then in these patients, we have to minimize, whenever we are doing any kind of treatment, we should make sure that we minimize any kind of soft tissue trauma. So that brings us to the end of the video. So we will be continuing with the dental considerations in the part 2 of the video. So if you have liked the video, do hit the like button and don't forget to share and subscribe. And thank you so much for watching. Thank you.